Hello, hello, hello. Welcome back. Welcome back. We got another special episode that we're bringing to you live. We got a triple OG himself in the building. A lot of respect. Can you introduce yourself, please?
My name is Virgil Fairley. My handle is the great, great, great grandmaster. That's what I'm known for all over the country. When they say the grandmaster, it moved mountains.
Now, that name alone, that you didn't self-proclaim that to yourself, right?
No, actually, a friend of mine by the name of Minister Simo gave me that name because, you know, once you get your record check on everything you've done in the last 60 years, it was so powerful that he said, you're the oldest and the most strongest one to come out of the game that was pretty successful. And when he got to run to make, he said, the great, great, great grandmaster is what fits your handle. That's how I got to the name.
Well, you definitely present yourself as a grandmaster here. Yeah. So what was it like as a childhood? How did you see your vision? Did you see where you're at right now?
No, never thought about it. It was so far-fetched because I come up in a time when poverty, what number of poverty? People didn't even have cars to drive, lived in the projects, the kids was half shoes run over and holy pants, which they wearing holy pants now, but it's a style number back then. It wasn't, you get laughed at, you know. Mm-hmm. I just happened to come up under a little better background and upcoming than what they did, you know, but all these was my friends, you know. I started in, my mother and father used to work. They only had a mother, no father. So these the people that I catered to. Starting out, I could start out being a smart kid in school. And our particular one day we had they at school had a spelling test. So I'll spell everybody in the school but one person. And I lost that on purpose because when you smart in school back when I was coming up, it was like you said Diddy in your square, and that's what I didn't want. I missed the word on purpose so I could be with all the underdogs. But people used to have buses lined up 4 o'clock in the morning when you go pick cotton and cut grapes. And that's the only thing I knew and remember coming up as a kid. That's something that I didn't want. So my mother used to give me these instruments to play, like the trombone and violin, but that wasn't cool enough for me. I recognized something way back then that I wasn't accepting. And everything I come up with all the way till I was 18 years old, I wasn't accepting. She wanted me to get a job and go to work. So I finally got a job. Finally, went to work. I passed a test for the city. I passed one for the county. I went and bought me a 61 Cadillac convertible. Not knowing my intentions was always in the streets, but not, it was just survival tactics. It wasn't thriving, it was surviving. So right before that, I was in high school. And I used to see this guy riding through in a new Cadillac, riding through, leaning. And I go to the window to sharpen my pencil. So I stayed there 5 or 6 minutes. My mind is straight on him, and I forgot about everything in the classroom. I'm watching them, you know. So they come back again. So on the weekend, we went downtown. It was a place called Chinatown where all the, like the red light district, where all the prostitutes and everything would work. is about one guy in town that I paid attention to by the name of Milton Peters. He was the sharpest guy I ever seen in my life. So me and a partner of mine was across the street watching everything. This before all this took effect with me. So he comes to about 2 miles an hour in a convertible Cadillac. It was sure pretty Eldorado. That fascinated me so much. I had never seen nothing that beautiful in my life. You know, it's like a movie coming through. So the as he rolled through, all the ladies looked. At this time, ladies not supposed to look at the cars or the fellas, but you couldn't help from looking at beauty. And they say, that's Milton Peters. That's the man. So getting back to we got our feet wet when I bought the Cadillac. You know, another friend of mine, we graduated from school. Like I said, I had the Cadillac now. I was working. But I had got two letters in the mail for about a month later. And they say, you're fired. So about another week went by, and they say, you're fired again. So the two jobs that I had for life, they fired me from them. So I'm riding down Fresno Street in my Cadillac with the top down. And some lights start blinking off and on. So I pull over, and two girls jumped out. They were prostitutes. They say, can I ride with you? I say, yeah, come on. Because I knew one of them from school, you know. They had got a little fast. They come out in the game a little faster than what we did, you know. So one girl from Oakland, I'm from Fresno. So she looked upside my head and said, ooh, I like him. So the girl told me, said, won't you give him some money and choose him? So before I get down Chinatown and drop him off, she done gave me some money. So I put her down. Now, I'm just getting my feet wet at the time. And she started getting down, and she started paying the pants. So now it's time for me to get a new car, because I used to catch a woman. My motto, catch a new woman, I buy a new car. I give them something to do, you know.
Gotta give them a car candy.
Yeah. So I never smoked and wasn't drinking or none of that, you know, because I kind of come up in the life that you didn't do none of that. You know, all my friends did everything. They smoked weed, cigarettes, alcohol every weekend. I just didn't do none of that, you know. She was a smoker. And all night long, I hear them cigarettes scratching all night long. I got so sick of that. See, I'm getting rid of her, but now I went and bought me a new convertible Cadillac now, so I'm ready to get rid of her and get my feet wet and ready to get out. So Milton Peters, the boss of bosses in the town, they called a case. So that shot him to the penitentiary. By us being the youngsters coming up, getting our feet wet in the game, what number me and a friend of mine, we start making all the noise in the town as a youngster. I turned 20 years old, and it was a club that we were trying to get into. He may have been a little bit, a couple months older than me. So he could go in, but I couldn't. So we sit on the front of my car until 12 o'clock that night and went up to the door and said, now you can come in, you're 21. I got chose that night. So a couple months later, I was like 5, 6, 7 deep, you know. So it went on and on and on from there. But this book here, from the inside out, tell you my whole life about the game, you know, about my whole life. Real velvet book. This is the gangster book. Tell you how things done in the penitentiary. And real good read. This is my film, My Life, Over the Top. That was number one for a long, long time. I also have a movie out called A Familiar Lie. Excuse me, Baby in the Hood. I done filmed with Omar Gooding. Several movies. Matter of fact, he's in A Familiar Lie. So I've been pushing the line on these movies and stuff after 60 years of success in the life and the game, you know. And I've been trying to give back to the kids when they come to me for information. I tell them the right thing to do. Everybody can't do what I did and last for 60 years and stay on top for 60 years straight. Mm. From the time Milton Peters left, he got out of penitentiary, he ran with me. I looked out and took care of him, a guy that I used to look up to. We rode together every day until he died. So that's kind of how my success went. And, you know, I didn't see many of them come, and I didn't see many of them go. They couldn't stand strong enough to stand up for this game for years. Some of them made a name for 5 years. Some of them made a name for 12 years. Some of them made a year for 15 years. A couple of them may have had 18 years, but they all fall off. What kept me so strong? When I was young, I used to ride through, and they look at a guy bent all over, and they tell me how powerful he used to be in the life. And he bent over a trash can with nothing. Then here's go another one. There go another one. I put in my mind I wasn't going to go out like that.
All the failures.
Yeah. So I stayed strong.
Now, let me ask you a question. Do you think their success got the best of them at the time to where they supersede themselves and, you know, they capitalized themselves in that field? Or
no.
It just wasn't for them?
No. Things happen in life. It's not, all glitters are not gold. It's not no roller coaster. It's a roller coaster ride and a bumpy ride, and you got dead ends. But you got to be smart enough to dance around them there and be dedicated to what your craft, to what you do. I believed in me. That's what kept me strong. They start believing in themselves. When they start having them roadblocks, they start falling by the wayside because they didn't know what to do. Mm-hmm. I stayed strong. If I leak, I never leak no more in a month or so. You know? I mean, that's, you know what leaking is, right? Yeah, I never leak no more in a month or so because I stayed down for my crown. You know, so I believed in me. And I stay strong. You can't hardly name too many people to stay strong. I used to run with the famous Ward brothers. You ever heard of them? The movie The Mac?
It's way back, right?
Yeah. Those is my friends. Milton Peters. All top-notch players I ran with. Fillmore Slim. There's just so many of them. But all of them looked up and respected me for my game because I stayed strong. You know, I never went back, got no job. Never done none of that. I stayed to what I believe. If I got to leaking, I wouldn't even go home. I had a home I could have went to. My mother and father worked every day. But I would not go back home. I stayed in the streets. Kept my feet to the ground. Kept my back to the game, you know? So it's take a lot of strength. It's
24 hours, right?
Yeah, of thinking. Because one thing about a female, she don't never stop thinking. And when you relax, she going to have your neck, your eyeballs and everything because you don't know what's on their mind. They think from the heart. We got to think from the mind because the man means mind, you know. So you got to stay on top of your game, on top of your business, you know. So I wouldn't advise no youngsters to go through what I went through. You know, as time go on, I had a problem doing a friend of mine a favor because sometimes you get off your stick, get off your bicycle, thing that you really know and have knowledge of. It ain't working good for you. But you get off that trying to help somebody else and you get charged. I had 20 cars, 5 houses, black bottom swimming pools, 12, 15 mink coats, $1 million worth of jewelry, money stacked up this high. Didn't think I had a worry in the world. Say, I'm stuck for life with success. Never thinking nothing could go wrong. Anything could go wrong at any time because you don't know what's lurking in the bush. Absolutely. The law of average will get you. They come through, wiped me out, took everything. I had one necktie hanging up out of all the tailor-made clothes I had. Mm. They took everything, coming down the steps with mink coats, laughing. You know, they stopped the Super Bowl, stopped the football game to put me on TV because they never see nobody live the way I was living, and they didn't know about it. So any little thing could happen. You know, you can think it happened accidentally where you trust somebody else and somebody else is hooked up with the wrong folks. They run their mouth or whatever, innocently, don't know, and cause you a problem, you know.
It's the way the chain of events work, you know. I mean, people, yeah, a lot of things don't know.
Yeah, so I had a lot of experience, you know. Experience bring knowledge, knowledge bring wisdom, you know. So I preach it to all the youngsters because I know it's a generation gap. Youngsters don't believe the OG can tell them anything. They got their own persona, their own group, everything they around. you're a victim of what you're around. You know that.
Basically, like, so if you listen to these musics, you know what I mean? You're getting these fake facades of life.
Yeah, right? Exactly. Yeah. They singing things, doing things they ain't never done, just hearsay or think up something, because they thinking of something to win with, you know? So they faking like they done all this. They ain't done none of that.
Maybe the ghostwriter did.
Yeah. So that's kind of how everything go, you know, with life, you know.
One thing I realized that you said, you know, as a child, back to that that spelling bee that you purposely flunked out.
Right.
You're like a chameleon. You can adapt and not be foreseen. You know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly.
That's a very unique thing to have. That's a unique trait. And I noticed you said that at a young age. You purposely flunked that out.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? Because you didn't want the limelight.
I didn't want it. Yeah.
You know, and that's a lot of people fail to realize success. You don't need the limelight to be there.
I used to lay back when I was coming up with all my friends. I was the biggest one out of all of them, but I laid back. I was humble. They didn't know my movie because, you know, big games play smooth out of sight, you know. And I just happened to use my book sense and use that in the streets. So that made me win. None of my friends could pin me down. He used to get mad at me because I lay back and acting normal like I'm not doing it, but I got more money than all of them to put together, you know. So I had a brand new Rolls Royce, Golden Spirit Zimmer, Benz, the Vet. Had all the toys and everything, you know, that people can only wish they had, you know. You know, come from the game, you know.
How can we transition out of Cadillacs?
Huh?
How can we transition out of Cadillacs in the beginning?
You know why? Because as time went on, people couldn't afford Cadillacs. Remember that, right? Started way back. And after so much time, things transitioned and people on welfare start buying Cadillac, but they like 10, 15 years old because everybody wanted a Cadillac. But players is the only one that drove them. If you see a player coming through, you know it's a player, no matter where you're at. Down the highway.
The eye candy, you see it.
Yeah, you see it, you recognize that. Go a player right there. But everybody started getting them. So I jumped from that to the Mercedes. When they started getting Mercedes, I jumped to that to the Bentleys and Rolls Royces. And I've been standing strong with that ever since. They stopped it to Mercedes.
You see that new Rolls Royce that he dropping, that like conversion van type thing?
Yeah.
I think it's different. And they said that's strictly for hip hop people.
Yeah, I got a girl talking about buying me a 2023 right now. See, I'm gonna be your goat. Yeah.
Nice.
But yeah, the game, man, when it's played, it's good. It's fun when it's played right. But it never will be no days like it was before. You'll never see that again. Cause we had fun 7 days a week. We dressed 2-3 times a day, 7 days a week. Only the players was having it their way. We used to walk through the clubs. Women would stare at us like we the president of the United States, just like the police did and everybody else. They respected the game, but they didn't like it because they had to work. We didn't. And that was a time, man, when, you know, you're going to get an interview if you come through in a Cadillac. They want to know who you are because they know the only one to drive a Cadillac is players.
How would you measure success?
I measure success with, I used to measure with money, but I measure success now with health and comfortability. You know, because when your mind go, everything's gone. But if you successful with yourself and you comfortable, not strained up, don't have to worry every day, then you all right. I had a house that's worth $700,000-$800,000. And, my payments is high. I got another house here. But I spend a lot of money every month. But I'm doing better than everybody. I had a fella that I knew had a Section 8. The house wasn't nothing. But I envied him because he ain't had nothing to worry about. All it takes is one slip for me, and I'm just like he is. So as time go on, I measure success with success. I'd like to be healthy, comfortable, and financially set. That's how much success is. My mind don't never stop. I'm still climbing. I've never been satisfied, no matter what I had.
How do you exercise your brain on a daily basis now?
I think a lot. You know, I ride and keep things going because I'm almost 70. I'll be 78 September 8th, you know. And I thank God every day for carrying me through this journey because it's not easy. I wouldn't advise no youngsters to go through that because they're not going to make it.
Especially nowadays.
Not going to make it. So I was able to crawl through the clinches. By ride on the clouds and kept it smooth, you know. So I give it all to the man upstairs because I ain't that sharp. You know, I had help.
What was your view of the guidance that you provided, you know, to these young ladies? Like, how did you always make sure that they were safe and everything? Like, what was that like?
Well, you're talking about on the track or whatever?
Yeah, whatever.
Well, on the track, see, you know, this game is a secret society. Only the inside is really aware of, you know. You don't ever give up too much game because a hip square can jack the whole game off because they overhip and they steal a square and they don't understand what the language is, what the movement is. And you got to come up through the ranks to understand this here. So back in the day, it might be 25 prostitutes on the corner. If a Mark get out of line with one of them, all 25 going to attack him. He going to be cut, maybe shot, beat in the head with heels, and you ain't finna whoop no 25 prostitutes because they going in for the kill. Yeah, they going to try to fix it where you don't come out of that. And they protect themselves. A lot of people don't know that, you know, but that's what happened.
That's your livelihood.
Yeah. That's what they do. It's just like when you look at TV and see the Indians attacking. That's what they do. One girl holler, everybody's coming. And they're going to hurt the trick.
So your brain setting is always thinking. And like I said, I heard you say you don't consume no alcohol, you don't puff on no cigarettes or
I don't do none of that.
And I've been doing this interview stuff for a long time, and I've interviewed somebody else that thinks the same way. And you guys kind of have very similar brain settings because you guys are always playing chess. You know what I mean? Life's you don't want to push your pawn too far.
Right, right.
And what I see is, you know what I mean, those unclouded brains are very unique.
Yeah, yeah. You know, I don't know if you ever heard of TA. You ever heard of that? It's short for transaction analysis. You heard of that? Okay, that's what I was really in tune with. A lot of people not in tune with that. And I see things that other people can't see. And I recognize things other people can't recognize. I see them when they don't even see themselves. Sometimes I can't say nothing until they're ready to accept or understand. Because it'll be a big mistake. You're going to fall out with them. They're going to think this and think that. And all you're trying to do is help. Mm. So you got to kind of just hold back, you know. You got to be real sharp. A lot of people think they're sharp, but they're really dumb. You know.
It's just like sports. If you don't stay active, you're going to lose it.
Yeah, right. You don't use it, you lose it. So that's kind of where it was at, you know. Mm. But, yeah, it's life is beautiful. See, when I went to penitentiary, when I fell off, life wasn't the same. Everything changed. So I had to transition myself and go back in and revamp myself in order to get where I'm at now. They took everything and laid me down.
How long was you waiting for?
They gave me 10 years, but I gave them 5 back. So I had to use my knowledge and my sense, take my time, not be in no rush, because, you know, speed will kill. And I revamped my whole thing, and I did it in a flash.
So utilize that time as like an educational
purpose. Oh, yeah, no doubt. That's why I come up with the books and everything. Mm. I didn't waste my time. I exercised, got my body and my mind together. And I had never been even done a day in jail. My friends used to say, man, he taking over the whole penitentiary. He ain't never been to jail. How he do that? You know, I had a lot of followers, Crips and the Bloods. I'm the one who put the Crips and the Bloods on the same team running track. And they was really mad at each other, but they respect me so much. they get up under me. Sometimes I had some on this side and that side, but they wouldn't talk to each other, but they talked to me. So I put them together, but now it's I still got them right now. They still calls me right now out of respect, you know. They love me, you know.
So there's no violent situations around that. It was all respect.
No, all respect.
Now, do you think in those respectful times, bonds were united, or do you think the separation still from the color range?
Well, I think it's a lot better than what it was. You might have a few because actually become habits. You know, that's been going on for a long, long time. So when somebody powerful come on and break that mold, you know, and you still have some with that. They don't move on it, but it's something in the back of the mind, you know.
Still boggles them.
Yeah. But then you got something to get along real good. So it just all depends on the individual. You know, just like me, I can go all the world. I get along with everybody. I'm respected all over the world. You know, they pay me to do interviews. They pay me to do come out, just show up. Afro Man, you ever heard of him?
Afro Man?
Yeah. That's my man. He paid me to come out and just draw a crowd with him, you know.
Nice.
So I'll be with Snoop Dogg. I'll be at his house. I'll be with Harry O. You ever heard of him?
How can you be at Snoop's house and not puff on that good-ass butter he got?
Man, you know, they respect. They always respect what I do.
No, absolutely.
Which is nothing. And I just never had that. You know, I was never a follower. I was always a leader. Mm. We was coming up, man, all my friends and stuff, they all done the same thing. That I wouldn't cut like that. I mean, they tried to get me now. Don't get it wrong. Oh, man, you just square. No. But shit, they got to the point where they don't even offer me nothing. No, he don't drink. He don't smoke. Don't even worry about that. They get mad when you offer me something, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's a unique gang that, you know, your journey has led you up to.
Yeah. But, yeah, you know, the game, you know, like they used to say, the game don't change. People do. But it got to a point where the game and the people change. So you got to be smart enough to revamp and not be a follower and be a leader and do. See, one work for one and don't make work for everybody. You got to do what works for you. You know, and
each journey is different. You know, we all have our own different doors that we open and close.
Yeah, just like a fingerprint. Everybody ain't got the same, you know. Mm-hmm. But I revamped myself. Instead of getting mine off the concrete, I'm getting it off the top shelf, you know. So I never spread that, say anything. I just keep moving with success. They don't know how I move because they don't know how I think. And I know that sometimes people get up under you for the wrong reason. But I'm sure off enough to see what everybody is doing. When you got me, you got the best friend in your life and don't even know it. But I always had the thing that if I know you, I feel like you should know me.
Mutual.
I had a friend of mine. If I know you and you don't know me, it's something in there that's not good. And I had a friend of mine, he had this girl. Because if I give a person give me 100, I'm gonna give them 200 of the love. So we was up in Monterey. He had her down and everything. You know, I'm just up there, you know, just kicking it for the Monterey Jazz Festival, you know. So I see that he didn't got a little weak about the girl as long as he had. I didn't understand it, but I didn't speak on it because I had that kind of love for him. You know, that's your business. I know my get down is still the same. I'm still smashing the match, you know.
He didn't quit it. Yeah.
But I seen the difference, and I had a lot of respect for him. So I'm going to cut it. I'm just going to tell you the whole story, but I'm going to just cut in. But anyway, make a long story short, a year or two went by, and he had asked me something. Say, man, you would never cross me, would you? Man, I had so much love for this, like my brother, man. I felt insulted for you asking me that.
Because you're thinking about it. You think I did something to you.
Well, I want to know what it was, and I didn't know why that I was getting asked that question. So to make a long story short, 2 years went by. And he fell out with me. I didn't know why. But I'm about 19 deep at the time. You know, I'm on the road. You know, I'm getting money, you know. So when I come back through Reno, through Vegas, and come back, I stop at a partner's mine house, and he tell me, you know that girl's been through here. I said, what girl? He said, you know, your partner's girl, you know. I said, why, what's she doing over here? He said, you know what she doing to see you? I said, come on, man. I ain't never said nothing to that girl. So, man, I'm on the road again. I go back to Reno and Vegas again because, you know, I'm on a mission, you know. And so next time I come through the same spot, she on the phone again. So his woman gives me the phone. So when she give me the phone, the girl tell me who she is. So I said, well, how's your man? She said, I'm not with him anymore. And I said, okay. So I don't go into nothing because I don't, you know, I ain't going to run with my partner and mess with the girl at the same time. That's one I never done, you know. I ain't going to kick it with you and then kick it with the girl too. It got to be one or the other. If I'm going to kick it with the girl, I ain't saying nothing to you.
Does that line, yeah.
Yeah, I'm gonna let you know when I serve you, you know, you got to read the paper on the front page, you know, I'm going with it, you know. But anyway, she called me about a month later, but I'm holding off because he wouldn't speak to me no more. And I'm trying to think, what could happen?
Now, this was after a couple of years?
After a couple of years from initially. I said, what could happen? So she called me again and caught me on a bad note. I done got mad now because he done did some things that normally he wouldn't do. So now I know it's something. So I get so angry at this time, and I want to know what's going on. So I set up an invitation to lunch. She turned around and gave me, a lot of money. She wanted to be with me. I said, since you don't want to talk, you know, this is what it is. Now he comes and want to talk. Mm. I had done nothing, hadn't said nothing or nothing. But women come with bad intentions sometimes. So when I get all this money and I see how to lie, she, but I'm trying to shift and shoot her back to him because I did my job. I didn't let her play with me. Other guys let him play with them, but I didn't let him play with me, so I was still strong. So any other time, a guy would congratulate you for breaking a bra and doing whatever, you know, because some guys let her come in and they play with you, go have sex with them and everything, just show weakness to the game, you know.
Absolutely.
I didn't do none of that. Man, come to find out, she had been feeding him poison for 2 years, and I didn't know about me, lying.
So that's where those questions arose from.
Yeah. I found that out 2 years later. I say, what? I had never said one thing to her out of line. Wouldn't even speak to her. She feeding him poison. And he bit hook, line, sinker, and all. And instead of bringing it to me, it never would have got to that point, you know.
And you guys were partners, right? That was your man.
I loved him. And he loved me. But a woman will jack you off if you keep listening because they don't never stop thinking. And what they thinking about don't make it concrete. It's just the emotions be moving around. And they can think of some stuff so far-fetched that you would never think of in your life. And make yourself believe it.
It's those lies that they think.
You know? Yeah. So that's part of what happened with a lot of guys, you know, when it comes to the game, man. They get fall by the wayside because they relax. I never relax. I'm checking mine right now. If I had it for 40 years, I'm still checking like I did the first day. Because you got to react on that. You got to pump a certain kind of fear in them, let them know don't play with you. Because the longer it go, the more relaxed, they try to weigh you down. You know?
It's like a fucking anchor on a boat.
Yeah. They'll try to weigh you down.
It's going to find the bottom eventually.
And if you weak, soft, they're going to weigh you down trying to make a deal. Because they don't stop thinking. You stop thinking, you relax. Yeah, they're going to catch you with your bullets out of your gun. So, yeah, that's kind of how I go, you know.
So with all these books and everything, when you were incarcerated, did you, like, was this your return of you're going to come back bigger and better? Or?
No, I always had a positive attitude about life, period, about winning. I've never not had it no other way. My mind is always about winning, even right now. And I did a lot better than a whole lot of other players. But I still didn't accept less for the best. I'm thriving for the clouds, you know. And my thing really was doing this here. A lot of things start fading out and the new start coming in. So when I wrote these books, a lot of people start dying off. And we needed some history to stand up. So I started writing on, I was one of the only ones left. So I started writing on that note, you know. So after I began writing, I still was thinking maybe I can get a movie deal. Instead of taking chances throwing rocks in the penitentiary. You know, because I found out, man, on my way to Las Vegas to Nellis, when I left the streets, they didn't get 85 cents on a dollar an hour. I didn't want no parts of that action. I stayed in the game so long, it took me riding to the penitentiary in the van, sitting back with my head back, and seeing two guys talking. He said, these feds are so dirty, they got $50 million of my money. The other guy said, you're right. They got $30 million of mine. He said, they're dirty. I looked this way, and I looked this way as two white guys. I said, I must be the biggest fool in the world. I kind of found out that people's making $100,000 a year. If I had any idea that was going like that, I'd have been right with them. But all I remember was a dollar an hour and 85 cents, $4 a day. Picking cotton, cutting grapes. That's what people was doing.
And they was making that much money?
And that took me 20 some years to find out that people's really making money on the job. I didn't know. That's how far away from that square stuff, you know.
So you would go back and done it differently, you say?
All that. Yeah, I'd have been right with them.
Right back over there with them working, huh?
Yeah, I didn't know. You know, I that's how far I stayed away from that, you know.
So what would you suggest to somebody right now that's up and coming, you know, out of school or something, and they might be stuck in a little rut right now of making a right and wrong decision?
Well, I'll tell them to rock with it. Get education. Go to school, cause that's how you're going to win, you know, get your credit good. And it's not going to stay bad forever. Just, you know, fight for your title, you know. If I fall for the title in the streets, I know they can fight for the title in the school, you know. And you just got to stick to the strip, you know.
Besides the success, what was your motivated drive?
Success. That's my motivated drive. I want to have nice things. I was like that since I was a kid, you know.
There was just never enough.
Yeah, it wasn't on me. It was in me. I just had to develop what direction I was going because I didn't know at first. I never thought I'd be one of the greatest players in the world. I didn't know that. That was so far from my mind, that's not even what I was looking for. It's not even what I was after. I just wanted to survive without having to get a dollar an hour. And when I found out that I can get $100 a day, I was off and running. That's how it started out. That $100 a day started out to being $6,000, $7,000 a day as time went on, you know. Some people took it serious. Some guys didn't. I always took everything I'd done very seriously. You can't play with life, no kind of way.
Yeah. Were you always a visual or a verbal teacher or a visual teacher, like with your surrounding people that you surrounded yourself with?
I was visual, and I used to talk good. I used to talk better than Taylor could sing. Coming up because I was young and buck wild, you know, until I really started having big money and I toned myself down, humbled myself because I didn't have nothing to prove. Yo, it was real with me. Everybody that has something to prove, you're going to hear them flabbergasting and running a mile for a time trying to prove. Other people can see that. You act like you're not used to nothing. So I was one of the first ones to humble myself and laid back. I didn't have to show myself. Everybody knew. I ain't never told nobody I was a millionaire. Not one person. But you go anywhere in the country, they're going to say that. So you don't have to blast your actions speak for itself. You know, I hear, I done seen it all, you know.
I see you had a lot of close ties back in the day. And the one article says that you even had close ties with Italians, huh?
Yeah. They was so, my friends. I raised up with them. They loved me to death.
Now, back in that time, what was it like with the culture divisions that was going on there? Like, because that was back in the day, right?
In the 60s.
60s.
I messed with them all the way until 60s, 70s, 80s. And I think my friend might have died sometime after that, all of them. But we was like this. Love me. See, all the older people loved me because I was one of the sharpest youngsters they'd ever seen. And I come up right because I was taught right. My word was good. If I'm with you, I'm with you 200%. You know, I'm riding with you till the wheels fall off. I'm going to give you 100 points. You got to break it down yourself. I'm not going to give you no 50. I'm going to give you 100. You got to tear it down. Because I'm going to keep it real with you. I had a guy one time I raised. See, if you know better, you do better. Some people don't care. You can love somebody too much, but if they're not on your level, it could harm you mentally. So some people you got to love from a distance, you know, because they would create roadblocks for you because they don't have that mindset of understanding.
So you didn't overextend your love too much. You know what I mean?
Well, my love is there, but it's from a distance.
You put the arm up to where.
Yeah, but if I see you and you right with me, I got you. I got you. But most of them will fall off because you got them, they don't have you. You know? And I see who's who. I know who's who. My job is to try to nourish them and feed them righteousness instead of negativity. But some people is not receptive to that. So you got to kind of fall back. Watch them from the outside. Just protect them. Watch them from the outside.
Yeah. See, I remember when I was ripping and running before I got incarcerated and whatnot, elders used to always come to me, settle down, you know what I mean? Try to guide you in the right direction, but you had those blinders on to where you're not looking at nothing.
Exactly. You know, see, me, I would always listen to my OGs. They educate me. Even the dope fiends and the winos, I found out was smart. You go to them people to slit on them tents. They got tents here? Some of them people are smart. They just messed up in the head. Mm-hmm. But they're smart. I see them doing some things I could never do. They got the TV playing and all that stuff out there. I see, shit, I can't do that.
They figured it out, though.
Yeah, they can do it.
Each human's body has a unique brain, you know, and people just need to tap into it.
Yeah, I used to sit and talk to him when I was a kid because I was hungry for knowledge. And the people that I learned from, a lot of them, they was never nothing themselves. But I took what they told me, and I turned into my knowledge and made something out of it. Same thing, I got the information I got from them. They never knew how to use it. I was successful with it.
So what's the impression you think you left out so far with your journey that you've created?
What's the impression I leave? Being old as I am and staying on top for 60 years straight. Success. But I'm not finished with success. I'm still on my journey. Mm. Yeah.
So what are some of the upcoming things? Is there anything upcoming that we should pay to?
Yeah, well, you know, I've got a 9-part series called The Grandmaster that should be out on Sheen TV. Maybe out now. I don't know. It should have been out the next couple of days before I got here. And it's a 9-part series. This lady flew in named Rita from Chicago because she was paying attention to me and she liked it, everything I was doing. And she come in and interviewed me, you know. So you got my son, which is the Cali Cash, my grandson caked up wheel. So we're gonna do this as a trio and a great great grandmaster. Mm. Yeah, because they both real velvet artists, you know. So we're gonna do it as a trio. She had that vision.
Where can people find your books and stuff at?
This is Amazon. Death is Not a Game. Amazon. My Life Over Top. Amazon. From the Inside Out. Amazon.
During the show, we'd like to ask the individual, what's one jewel that you could share with the viewers that you can uplift and maybe guide them in a better direction? One jewel that all these years that you have done, that you have learned, all the knowledge you have accommodated, in the best format of words.
Well, you know, most everybody have kids, you know. And a lot of us come up making mistakes or doing things that our kids is not aware of and don't understand. Because, you know, it's always three sides to every story. And the story that they not understand, the story that's hard to get to them, the reason why you had to do what you had to do. And a lot of them is not receptive to that. They're not going to never understand it. And then sometimes you have to grow into years to come by and to develop an understanding about life, period. I got one son that understand everything. He didn't start out like that. Everything I told him happened just like I told him. So he understands better than any of my kids. But the rest of them still process and still working. So I see a lot of people go through cycles with their kids and they be real close. I wish I could have done that, but my job was not to stay. My job was on the road doing things. So all I did was come home and just give my kids money because my job was in the streets. But they don't understand that because they're looking for the father they love, you know, the mother they love or whatever, you know. So that's one thing that I would like to share that I wish I could have been that guy to be home every day with the kids doing this and that. But had I did that, I never could have had the success that's going on now. So everybody got their own lane. That just happened to be mine, you know.
That was deep. That was, definitely could relate to that.
Yeah. I was angry at my father for years for being silly and stupid. But my father was good. My mother was good. I used to get angry because I asked for $20 and she didn't have it. I thought she was playing. And I didn't think mothers and fathers could be broke and struggling. And people think a lot about their parents. And I don't know if it's good or it's bad, but I guess it's respect because they think their parents can't do no wrong. And when they don't understand the struggle that's being dealt out here with paying your bills and getting laid off from work and trying to keep food on the table. They don't know what the parents even go through. They don't even think about it. They don't even care. They just want it to be done. So that's the hardest thing in the world for them to understand. My kids ain't never had to worry about nothing coming up. But they still don't understand that fatherly love that wasn't there. I love them because I made sure they had everything. But that didn't mean that much to them. They want you there. So being there gonna make you starve to death. You understand that?
Has any of them come to you over the years and asked you that? Why weren't you there or no?
No, well, not really. It's that, like I say, I can see things, so I know things. Mm. And they'll downplay it because out of respect. But some of them accept and some of them don't, you know. And because they just don't understand. But it's not bad, not on my part. But I know it's not all the way above board either. You know, because it took me to be over 50 years old to really just accept everything about my father. So you have to grow into that.
So you said it took you 50 years to grow into that. And I understand you said you didn't really care for him
growing up? No, it wasn't. I didn't care. It's just that I thought I wasn't getting the kind of love, you know. But you have to have knowledge enough to understand how the next person is thinking. And when I diagnosed it down to my father, people didn't have nothing coming up. So they wanted their kids to be something. If the kids is something, make them something. But the kids is nobody that make them nobody. And you're looking at other kids that might have a little bit more available stability, and they just don't know nothing else to do other than that. So they had to drive and thrive for what they know. That's to go get educated and go do their work and struggle like they've been doing until everything changed. I seen the whole change about 18 years ago when people start having things. It might have been 2001. People driving new cars, people weren't doing that. Everybody driving new cars, living nice. That was the change in life. I saw it happen.
Life changing.
Yeah, I saw it happen.
So now with that change that happened, now would you say that we're going backwards from that change that you've seen? The recession with like the COVID and the economy going down and...
I wouldn't say that. I'm saying you got to keep up with time, because the time that I'm telling you about, everything started advancing. And if you stand up to speed with what's going on, you're going to win. Got to put yourself in position. The people that wasn't doing anything when I was coming up is doing everything now. A player had everything back then. It's reverse charges. Now the squares got everything, and the player's looking at them. I seen it happen. So we was getting that kind of money, you know. They wasn't. They was looking at with their eyes this big. Police and everybody. Police start making a whole lot of money on the force. Correction office, all that stuff, you know. They wasn't making that kind of money back then.
All that taxation money.
Yeah. So, you know, you got people in positions like to fix the roads on the highways. You notice the roads are staying raggedy. Man, people are stealing that money. Because you got one person in charge. They don't even think about nothing else but their own job. So they sign a check. Here's $15 million. Ain't nobody else even finna look at that. You finna do everything you want with that money. Pay a little this, pay a little that, whoever know. Pocket the rest of it. It might be 20 years before you know if they got a case where they then looked into something. But then they bought everything, you know?
It's already gone.
Yeah. So it's a lot of things when it comes to life, you're not up to speed with it. But if you look at it, you can see it. Man, this is...
It's funny that you say that. Because there's a lot of that going on around, you know? Yeah. And my eyes didn't really open to that until I recently got out and really started challenging things and examining things and start using my brain.
Everything is capitalism, you know? Everything is capitalism. Police killing everybody. I tell everybody, y'all can't see what's going on. They got the service. People go to the service. They train them to kill. They get out the service, then they go be a police. That's all they know is to kill. Y'all can't see what's happening. It's just like killing a chicken to them. That's what they train to do. Mind condition. They not thinking for themselves. They thinking for the military. You got to look and see what's happening. They ain't scared to kill again. Everybody march, 10,000 people march, challenge the state and all that. We're going to see what we can do. They play it off, prolong it, kill again, laughing. They don't care about that.
They don't care about it because those people that are dying don't even...
All you got to do is...
They're brainwashing them.
Yeah, and brainwashed. Open your eyes, you can see what's going on.
I mean, it just goes right back to history. You know, there's a lot of things that don't get taught, you know, the truth.
Yeah.
They hold the truth.
Yeah, so... It's pretty easy when you got a mind and can think, you know.
That's crazy because I noticed this native guy, and he says you are given a brain to operate and decipher things.
Exactly.
You don't take for granted for what somebody says. Okay, if you can't open that door, well, why can't you open that door? You got to use your brain to, you know, it's we all have our own brains to think.
Yeah, everything ain't for everybody, but, you know, unity brings power. You do things as a group. You're going to the White House. They got a million people up in there doing different things. President can't do nothing, but the unity all together makes it happen.
And they're all still robbing.
Yeah, everybody got their own lane.
Yeah. It's definitely been a unique interview, and you know, we really appreciate you stopping on out.
Right.
Is there any besides your books, is there any platforms that people can follow you on or
Yeah, you can go to Big Virgil Grandmaster for my IG. Facebook is Ray Fairley, RayFairley. You can follow me on that, see everything I'm doing. Virgilbooks.com, my website.
Well, we appreciate you stopping on out, sharing your story, and, you know, the Grandmaster himself.
Right on.
Thank you. You wanna know how long am I?